American. It's just not the way we're, it's not in our DNA to think tomorrow will be worse than today. And unfortunately, we've got to plan for that.
Could another fear, I mean, it's been very newsworthy in the last few months, last few years, the use of performance-enhancing drugs with our athletes, whether they're Olympic athletes, whether they're athletes in our professional sports leagues, and how the fans deal with that, think about the athletes and their teams the same way, think about the Olympics and those incredible athletes in the same way, knowing that they have used and testing. Is this perhaps a concern down the road for us?
I'm much more concerned about terrorism. I'm not endorsing what we're going through in a lot of sports. I know we are partners on the Tour of California, which is the number one cycling event in the United States, and hopefully one that continues to grow. But I'm much, you know, terrorism is, you want to talk about a game changer? That's a game changer. And that's something we didn't have to deal with 20 years ago. And today, there's not a live event out there anywhere in the world that doesn't have to worry about that. Can you imagine what happens to this industry if someone walks into an arena or a stadium and detonates a bomb? Just think what that does to the live experience and how it changes sports forever. And it's not just sports. If they do it in a mall, if they do it in a movie theater, the change in the industry is going to be unbelievable. Again, I'm not endorsing the fact that we have issues and steroids that we have to deal with in sports, especially baseball. But that said, what would keep me up at night and does keep me up at night is I don't think it's a question of if. I think it's a question of when. And when that happens, that is going to be a game changer.
Well, what can you do to prevent that in what's in your hands?
Well, I think you've seen if you go to a Super Bowl, you go to the Olympics, you go to any Final Four event, any championship event in sports, the amount of money we now spend on security is crazy. But I can tell you one thing that every security expert we've talked to, and we have thousands of people that work in our company or for our company dealing with this very issue. And the one thing everyone says is you won't prevent it. It's like they used to say about the assassination of the President of the United States. If somebody is hell-bent on doing it and they're willing to die doing it, it's probably going to happen. And so my issue is there is no sure thing to prevent that from happening. And as I said, every security expert I've ever met says it's not a question of if, it's a question of when. It's going to happen.
Let me just make a couple of comments on the performance-enhancing drug thing. Clearly, you know, a major issue for all of us in sports. Our league has a zero-tolerance policy. You get no kicks at the can. If you fail once, I have the right to cancel any player's contract. Our union agreed to that because they wanted to really lead pro sports, at least in the United States, by example. We had our first two failures just at the end of last year after 14 years, and it wasn't an intentional usage. It was two guys that took an over-the-counter product from a drug, from a vitamin store, metabolized into steroids. So the athlete has to take responsibility for this. All the leagues can do is ensure that they have very, very firm policy, lead with strong discipline, if you will. We believe that we've got to protect the health of our athletes, but we also have to be role models for all those kids out there that are looking to our athletes as people that they hope to be at some point. I think, unfortunately, the fan doesn't care. It's evidenced by baseball had its best year ever. Clearly, they've had their challenges with performance-enhancing drugs. I don't think it's about our relationship with the fan. It's really our responsibility as corporate citizens and leaders of an industry.
Peter, you run EA Sports. What's your biggest fear?
Well, a little bit to Tim's point, I think, and we're in 2020 here, is what is the role of the physical spectator in a world where more and more sports have been developed for television? And the virtualization, the connectivity that we're now, certainly what we do at EA Sports, every 24 hours we host about 3 million games around the world, virtual games of whether it's American football or basketball or soccer through our games. And the fear I have is that we start to continue to virtualize, and again, the fear is that I continue to be even more successful and take away the power and beauty of sports that we grew up as fans going to the stadium and make this more, something that you watch on television but you don't get to experience. The ability for us in our industry to bring the personal access to the emotion of sports is powerful. To a kid, we create sports fans at EA Sports. if you talk to a fan of the NFL that's under the age of 30, a lot of them will tell you that their first real impact was playing Madden football. You talk to a lot of Americans who now learn to love soccer, they'll say, I picked up FIFA in 1996 and started to play it on my PlayStation. I started to learn about soccer players then, and I picked an English team or a Spanish team or an Italian team. So we do create fans. The other thing we do, though, that I fear about personally is that we also take them away from the real thing. And by 2020, are there going to be stadiums where there are no fans? And they're simply going to be broadcast because we rely less on fans than we did 30 years ago for revenue. Again, going back to my Liverpool days, it was money through the turnstile that kept teams afloat. That becomes less important today where it's rights issues, sponsorship, naming rights, and stadiums. So I guess the culture of what I grew up with as a working class in Liverpool and lived for 3 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon, I don't sense that anymore, and I think we're losing that. And so we have the power in our industry to use the digital platform to bring that back rather than to put it at arm's length of what we all grew up as kids living.
You know, I think the tools that are creating fans are different. It's now more EA, it's watching SportsCenter, than it's playing the game. To me, I worry about, again, as a parent and as somebody that's hoping to build a nation of soccer folks here in this country, it's participation that's affected by people playing these games more so than their connection as fans. Frankly, the more people that play FIFA that see MLS connected to Liverpool or see Madden and are going to be connected to a Cowboys game because they can't go because those tickets are now $1,000, you know, it provides them an opportunity to have an outlet to express their affinity to a club. Now, that might prevent them from playing football, basketball, or soccer, or baseball, but I think it's going to create more fans for us.
I mean, just an interesting point. We did some research because we're concerned about this. We're concerned about impacting, to Don's point, participation. University of Oregon, which has a center for a sports business and marketing, found out that people who've played Madden, American football, are smarter about American football than actually play the game itself. I mean, and that is empirical research. As sad as that might sound, because you learn what a cover two defense is when you're 8 years of age playing the game. And again, I believe it's a plus because we engender a love and a knowledge of the game. Same with our FIFA game, that only in FIFA can Liverpool play against the New England Revolution.
Could probably arrange that.
You should do. You need to get the
Galaxy playing against AC Milan on July 19th.
But again, that's a concern. I think we have a digital platform ahead of us that we need to grasp for good and make sure it doesn't actually negative impact what is all great about sports.
Yeah. Your original question, Linda, was what kept us awake at night that we wanted to prevent. And I would submit that we at ESPN have been very well served by not trying to prevent anything. We believe that things are going to change and people are going to move to different sports. They're going to move to different platforms. And our job is to get out in front of that and take advantage of it and build new businesses around it. And that's what we're trying to do. One of the things we are trying to get focused on is that I think does... nothing keeps me up at night. I can't stay awake during the day. But one of the things we think about all the time is how are we going to make money off of all the digital use? I mean, we know people are going there more and more. You saw David's slide. We have, I believe, the only broadband channel. It's called ESPN 360 that you cannot get for free. If you want to get ESPN 360, you can only get it through a distributor who pays us. And our intention is to take that stand and suggest that we're not going to give all our content away for free. There's a lot of free content on ESPN.com, but if you want to be an ESPN insider, which gets you deeper level of stats, recruiting information, you have to pay us. And I think a mistake that has been made is everybody giving the content away. It's a lovely thing to do if you're in a garage somewhere in south of San Jose and you're just having a fun time. But if you're a big corporation like the General Electric Corporation or the ESPN, part of the Walt Disney Company, or CBS, part of Viacom, you've got to figure out how to make money off of that so that you can write friends like you guys checks. So I can write Don a check. I can write them a check so that you can continue to support the federation, support the leagues, and fans will play. I will tell you, having had that long spiel, however, that despite sort of all these sort of issues we've had up here, one question we haven't talked about, and it's about 2020, is the centrality of sports. Sports is more central now, at least in the United States, than it has ever been in my lifetime. People care more about sports than they ever have. They watch more sports. I believe it's the case that the attendance is higher than it's ever been. Ticket sales are higher than they've ever been. People play more games than they've ever played. I think we're in a growth business. I would assume that includes most of your businesses. While we're in a big recession here in the United States, I'm very happy that we're in it in sports, because it's one thing people have not quit doing, I don't suspect they will quit doing, and whatever the issues are, steroids or terrorism, that's a sobering, was a sobering thought, Tim. Cheery thought.
She asked what kept me up at night.
Tim's got to be concerned about this.
She told the man told the truth. I ultimately believe we're in a big growth business here, and we're in a good place.
You know, great point. And Peter, I'd like to get back to something you said about how the fans that play these video games are more knowledgeable about that particular sport than they would be if they were actually playing the game. I find that fascinating. And do you think because of that, fans will be leaning toward that direction, meaning we spoke earlier about a term, we touched on it earlier, but user-generated content.
Yeah.
I think that's very important as we look ahead, because the voice of the fan, and could they be capable of, let's say, changing the way a league is run, changing the way a game is actually played?
I'll give you an instance where in our FIFA game, again, the world's best-selling video game on an annual basis, is we determined, in the old games of video games, you bought a cartridge, you bought a disc, that was the game, you played it, it didn't change. In these days of connectivity, we looked at a concept, we felt sports changes every single day. And particularly in the world of soccer or football, we now have a panel of 1,200 people, primarily looking at the English, French, Italian, German, and Spanish leagues. And we allow them to grade every single player that plays every game in all of those leagues, literally hundreds if not thousands of players. That data is then uploaded to our servers. It's called Live Season. And then it's sponsored by Adidas. We get money for it, John. You'll be comforted to hear. Then we download it when you log on, which most people do now who have video game consoles, and that data is updated in real time. So when my team is playing well, my team plays well in the virtual game. When my team isn't playing well, the individual players who have been marked poorly, that's reflected in the artificial intelligence of the game. A better example is what we do with the NBA. We do a thing called Dynamic DNA, which is now actually a recruiting tool for NBA general managers. Every player, every night in the NBA, we have somebody watch that player, watch who's on the court with them, and how they play when that player's on the court with them. That data is then recorded. We call it dynamic DNA. We upload it to the servers. So if Kobe's playing well when Gasol is on the court, then there's a different way in the game that he plays the next day. And this is what the community wants. This is what the fans want. It's no longer you make a game and it lasts the season. Sport changes every hour of every day, and in our world, we need to do that. That's making fans smarter about who's playing well, informed players, who they will be able to, if you will, select for the playoffs and think is going to go all the way. And to the extent where a lot of the GMs now in the NBA play our game to see how players play as a scouting tool for the team that's coming in to their arena that night.
Well, as you know, we use a virtual recreation that we get from Peter on our news and information to sometimes demonstrate plays and how they happen. It's called Virtual Playbook.
Yes.
It's much more effective than actually having real people.
Oh, yeah.
Because we can manipulate them.
And cheaper.
We can move them around.
It still gets us to go ooh and ah in the newsroom at ESPN. Like, we're like, oh, my God, you know, predicting the Super Bowl before the game is even played.
Right.
You know, I mean, crazy stuff like that. I'd like to know, though, again, as we look ahead, you mentioned GMs would turn to you and get this advice. Where are you guys going to turn? I mean, you try to be proactive. You try to be reactive. Mm-hmm. But what is the true definition of looking ahead? You don't have crystal balls. I know you don't have, John. So,
I got one. Yeah,
That's why
we're doing so well.
But how are you going to know? How are you going to know what's ahead in sport, when it has to do with the role you play in sport? Don?
Boy, it's a tough question, Linda, because it really depends on how developed your business is. You know, we're very young. I kind of describe our league as we're no longer an infant, we're sort of a toddler. And we're trying to get through these next couple of years and be healthy and strong and grow to get to the next level. And as a league, we, different than most businesses, we think in 3-year time periods. And we've got to keep very focused on being better next year and better the year after that and better the year after that and grow expansion-wise very carefully and strategically and think about the evolution of our player pool. And then we have certain things that we say, these are the next 5 and 10 years. A lot of that has to do with player development. A lot of that has to do with the changing demographics in our country, changing technologies that we try to stay in front of. I'd have to tell you, if we're sitting here in 2020 and I'm sitting on this panel, I'll be a whole lot smarter than I am today. But that's just not something that we as a league are really that focused on. One other point, though, our owners are getting much younger. We just sold a team to the Paulson family. His father is a bit older than he is, former Treasury Secretary, but the guy who will own the Portland team is 32 years old. Used to work at the NBA and ended up buying an MLS expansion team. He thinks about our business very differently than perhaps Phil Anschutz or Robert Kraft or Lamar Hunt used to think about business. So the more young owners that you could have, Joe Roth just bought our Seattle team. He's a Hollywood guy, very much believes in content, thinks about pro sports very differently than traditional guys. So from our business, we're trying to bring the right people into the family that could help us grow and evolve over the next decade or two.
How about you, Tim?
Well, can I add a twist to this again?
Of course.
Maybe a different way of saying this is, if you look at 2020, what is going to change our world, and what events or people out there or places are going to redefine our industry? So I think a huge moment in time for soccer, football, is going to be the World Cup, if we could bring it back to the U.S. in 2018 or 2022. If it can go from England in 2018 to the U.S. in 2022, I truly believe that that one event is going to revolutionize the sport in the United States. When soccer's World Cup came here in 94,
yeah,
right?
Four. Yeah.
In 1994, we were a nation that still didn't quite understand the sport, and we weren't as global a society as we will be in 2022. That has an opportunity to change the sport in this country forever and make it one of the top two or three sports. I think the same could be said about the NBA in China. What's going to happen with the NBA in China is scary. Yeah. I mean, it's unbelievable to see the phenomenal job David Stern has done with the NBA. By the way, ESPN is hugely popular in China. They just don't want to admit it because they're not supposed to be pulling it down. But if you go
once
there,
again, I'd like to remove myself from any further discussion of this matter.
Yeah, I know, because you want the billion people to pay you, which would be great, wouldn't it?
You know, I want to jump in on you something you said, Tim, about soccer and World Cup and bringing it to the U.S. I mean, I think in the United States, the sports that really make it on the driving force are sports that look good on television. The NFL, right? There's no bigger sport in this country than the NFL. It's a great TV sport. The NHL, my favorite, not a good TV sport. That's where it has problems.
Best sport in person, though, probably.
Great, right. What?
Best sport in person, probably.
Greatest sport in person. Believe me, I preach it. You're preaching to the choir right here. But that's the thing. So soccer, to me, as someone who did not grow up watching soccer, which I know that is the key, doesn't come across to me on television.
Well, Linda, look at Peter and George, who has
a
pretty successful...
You don't think Cristiano Ronaldo looks good on television, Linda?
She doesn't know who Cristiano Ronaldo is.
She knows who Cristiano Ronaldo is.
Yeah, but you know what? They're not posing. You know what I'm saying?
But Linda, think of how popular it is in other parts of the world, and people are watching it on television more than any other programming, dwarfing the combined television ratings of all the major leagues here in the United States. So the issue really isn't that it doesn't translate.
How do you make it watchable on TV in the United States?
Well, it's how do you make it more popular in the United States and get more fans? If you have fans, they'll watch it on television. Yeah. The issue is there are not enough fans here.
Yeah.
So as you grow your fans, they'll become fans of it on television. We've got a great contract with ESPN and Univision and Fox, and lots of people watching it. John, our Euro ratings are higher than a number of major league ratings. Mm-hmm. The World Cup final in 2006 was higher than the Baseball World Series final. People here in the United States watching more soccer than they watched the Game 7 of the World Series. So people will watch it. They're not watching a Major League Soccer enough. That's something we got to work on. But they're watching soccer here in huge ways.
The pertinent point of your question.
By the way, you got a lot of soccer fans on
the panel.
Yeah,
it's packed here. The pertinent part of your question was, I didn't grow up watching it.
Yes.
It's a canard that some sports are better than other on television. At this point, with the production values that we have, and with HD resolution, all sports are awesome on television. I sat in a hotel room in Beijing, and was in one of the IOC hotels. So I had those 20 channels where you got to watch every single event. Every single event looked great. I don't think that there is such a thing as, and if we put the production values, they look great. The thing I thought there is the question, it's a question of exposure. Again, it's a question that many, many people in this room deal with, and I was here when Dick Ebersol spoke and talked about how do we get, these sports are not on the stage except every 4 years in the winter and every 4 years in the summer. There is a production value to feature these sports all year long. We've talked about digital. I would think that the charge for lots of people in this room is, how do we get a year-round stage for our sports? The sports look fine. It's getting people interested in them, in the athletes, and finding the media outlet for them, other than those that beautiful Fortnite that Dick talked about. Anyway, that was slightly off subject, but.
Well, you know what? I'd love
I confuse you.
Yeah, well, I'd love to take some questions. You know, before I let you go, you know, we have a few minutes, unless you wanted to add something.
I mean, take questions.
I guess another way to look at this, I completely agree with John. This is about culture. It's not about production. It's not about, if we look, I mean, look at poker on TV. I still don't get it.
I don't either.
I mean,
that's
what
crazy.
The hell is everyone sitting there watching? You know,
it's those two cards in the hole.
It did well. It did well for a while.
Competition.
It did well for a while. Right now we're seeing it maybe too much.
No, it still does fine, and that was all about discovering the drama of the event, which is about the two cards. And until you can see that people have those two cards, you can't show it. For every sport there's a moment of drama that you have to figure out how to show, right?
Yeah.
I actually think we do fine on soccer. Is 90 minutes of drama. That's why I actually think it's going to work in the United States, is the level of tension throughout the contest. And I think it works fine, with all due respect,
yeah,
to my valued colleague.
Just playing devil's advocate.
It does fine on television.
John, wouldn't you say, I mean, the unique thing about soccer is, remember, it's the only sports league in this country that doesn't have the best athletes in the world playing in it. We have the best hockey players, best basketball players, best football players, and best baseball players playing in those four leagues. We don't have the best footballers in the world in this league yet. But he's trying to change that. He's right. The designated player is the first step. If we ever awaken to soccer in this country, then teams like Liverpool suddenly are going to have new challengers. And that's where we have to take the league. Because when you see the best athletes in the world playing in this sport, in this league, in this country, then I think you're suddenly going to see a passion. I mean, if you looked at Seattle the other night, my brother, who's the president of the football team up there, the NFL team, said it's probably one of the two or three best sporting events he's ever been to, the soccer game.
Yeah, no, I lived in Seattle for 3 years. I know that's a passionate sports fan base, so that was a great move to be there and have a team. But I hear what you're saying. You're absolutely right, John, because, again, I'm a hockey fan. I grew up watching hockey. Hockey's great to me on TV, but it is the best in person. So, again, if I grew up with soccer, I would see all the incredible moments that make soccer one of the world's greatest sports, arguably.
Linda, huh?
Well, so
everyone all of a sudden went after Linda on that one comment.
No, Linda's great. You're right, Linda. There's a hierarchy that works. If you're a fan, you just said it. If you're a fan, you want to see it live. Then you want to see it on a big screen. Then you want to see it on your computer at work if you cannot get home to see it in time. And then if you happen to be at some awful dinner party when your team is playing, you're going to get it on that little screen you carry around with you.
Not only that, I was on the plane here, didn't have a TV. I wanted updates on the New York Rangers, Minnesota Wild. The pilot got me updates after every period for what was going on with the score.
Well, you got the biggest screen. You got the big 747 screen, I guess.
We
refer to that as the best screen available. Right? And I would include a ticket in that. Your best screen available is the field in front of you. If you can't do that, you want as big a possible screen in a bar at your house. That really is how it works, in our opinion. I don't know. Should we take some questions?
Yeah, let's take some questions. Don't be shy. We'll get a microphone to you. Got to have one or two. Oh, there's one there. Get the microphone right to you.
Thank you. My question, again, is about football, soccer. I just wonder whether the problem maybe with football on TV in the States was the fact that they tried to make it American. I did a bit of research in Toronto FC, and the one big thing that they realized the fans there wanted is they wanted to keep it. They wanted to keep the true culture of football. Whereas, you know, the MLS started with, I think in the early years they had a shootout at the end of a game, and they try to make it American, whereas keeping it more true to what it is, like you'd probably watch it in England, maybe that would be more appealing, making it less American.
Look, I'm going to speak for Don here because I need to extol his virtues and what he's done. I was involved with MLS in the very early days, and I spent a lot of time on cold bleachers in Foxborough Stadium with the New England Revolution, abhorring the shootout. And in those days, in the early days, 95, 6, 7, the shootout was there, you're exactly right. There was a goal to Americanize the beautiful game. That did not work. The fact that draws can't be draws, that there needed to be drama at the end of the game, there had to be a winner, there had to be a loser. What Don has done, not only in more recent weeks, you've seen the expansion of the league and bringing soccer-crazy cities, particularly up and down the West Coast now here, and I said to him earlier, now you can drive to three franchises. You can drive between Portland and Seattle and Vancouver, and that shows the power of what this league is doing. But he and his team have done a tremendous job in paying homage to the game, to folding it in to me as a very discerning consumer to make it incredibly watchable, and to also, from the point of view of Tim brought up the designated player, recognizing the fact that we do need to start having within this league people who are superstars and recognized as superstars and bringing them in to not only be great players on the field, but I think to be role models, to be able to help the younger American players who are tremendous athletes to understand what the game is about. And Don's team has done a phenomenal job in doing that. So what you remember is most definitely in the past of MLS. What you see today and what I saw on Thursday night, albeit on television, is the future of MLS, which is as good a sports league as you'll find, maybe outside of the top three leagues in Europe, as regards its organization, its passion, the financial stability it's now showing, as well as the quality of play on the field, to be blunt. Now I'll let Don speak.
This is like a birthday party here. But, you know, just a couple of points that I think are, we've got to be careful in the football business, and I think most people in the audience are more connected with that sport than perhaps the American sports. Some of the great things that are happening with the U.S. leagues are the innovations with technology and rule changes that we in the football business have to be careful that we don't get too caught up in believing that tradition is religion. You know, the instant replay has changed and transformed American football. The virtual ball, the out line. On the tennis. And tennis right. has yeah. changed the USTA and the US Open. The shootout in hockey has made me come back to hockey and really enjoy what's going on in terms of a game resolution, not because I care about whether it's a tie or whether it has to be resolved by the end of the game. It's just exciting and more exciting than it was before that existed. So the first thing I did when I came in was change to go back to the traditional size of the game because the game is beautiful the way it is. But we've got to work with FIFA to have them open up a little bit and start thinking about perhaps evolving some of the issues that we have with refereeing, perhaps putting in a goal line instant replay or a goal line camera. I just read something coming out here that president of FIFA, Sepp Blatter, said the game needs no changes at all. It's been this way for hundreds of years. That's why we're different than all the American sports. Well, you know, we've got to think about some of the changes that could potentially make our game better, just like the change that we made with Major League Soccer, which clearly made our league and the sport here in this country better.
We're talking about the future trends in sports beyond current times into 2020. We're talking a lot about traditional sports and how they're going to change. We're talking about digital media and how important it is for young people and engaging young people. Where's the action sports going to come into this? Where's skiing going to come into this, freestyle? Where's snowboarding going to eventually come into this? I mean, snowboarding has absolutely killed at Olympics. Lastly, let's take a look at skateboarding. And how do you guys see those coming into your future plans for future fans and engaging them properly?
Well, we're the original perpetrators.
Yeah.
And we're very bullish on action sports and our winter and summer X. And again, I saw Mr. Ebersole up here with his suggestion that there needs to be openness towards incorporating some of those sports. We see that for a young audience, they love those sports. Another thing that's wonderful about those sports is the relative equality and the relative respect from the women to the men athletes in those sports. They really are quite consistent in that way with the Olympic ideal. These are pure athletes in a lot of ways. These young men, young women are doing this for the love of the sport. So we're very bullish on it. Those are important events to us. We are in the process of proliferating those around the world. We've had games in Dubai and Brazil and Thailand. We expect to be around Australia. We expect to be around the rest of the world with those events. And we're quite happy to be cooperative relative to the staging of those events and then what we do ultimately with the Olympic events. And, of course, my good partner, because it's just a love fest up here. My good partner in Los Angeles is Tim Lewicki.
I'll come talk to you about cycling if you love me so much.
Thank you very much.
So one thing I'd add to that is we've dabbled in a lot of extreme sports, and one thing we found is that the X Games is the brand and the event that takes it to another level, and that's no disrespect on all of the other events and activities within extreme sports, but it needs what they bring to it, which is credibility, huge eyeballs, huge audience, and they put it on a platform that at least for that week, the X Games are, you know, I still say one of the two or three best sporting events I've ever seen was, what's the kid that did the double?
Tony Hawk.
No, the kid that did the bike. The motor.
Travis Pastrana?
That was one of the greatest sporting events I've ever seen.
Yeah.
The kid misses just a half inch either way, he's dead. And he does a double backflip indoors on a motorcycle into the rafters amongst the steel and comes out of it and lands and hit it. By the way, he also said he'd never try it again after that because it was so dangerous.
I prefer to believe he'd been severely bruised had that happened.
Yeah. Depending on what your definition of severely is, you're right.
Question over here. James Worrell from Leaders in Football. Does the panel think that it's only a matter of time before a team outside of the MLS buys into a franchise in the MLS? And if so, who will it benefit more, the MLS, American soccer, or the team?
Well, James, you know, we have an investor, two of them now, that own foreign clubs. Chivas Guadalajara owns our second team in Los Angeles, Chivas USA. And Red Bull Austria owns a team in Salzburg and also owns our team in New York. FC Barcelona has been around.
We own a soccer team in Europe.
Well, that's true.
You forgot three.
Yeah, I was talking about them coming here, though. Going there.
All right.
And you're not supposed to own those teams overseas.
No, we only own 49%. It's okay.
So FC Barcelona, as you know, has been looking at investing in MLS, and I suppose they could be the team that probably gets closest, fastest to investing in our league. We could learn an incredible amount about what this league can be from those who've been doing it very, very successfully for a generation. And we welcome it and hope to see it happen sometime soon.
Last point on that, just because I love sticking this in there. I read all of these great columnists and, yes, occasionally sports analysts with their opinion about whether or not David Beckham's worked. Don will tell you that David Beckham has worked. We wouldn't be where we're at today if we didn't get the attention and the momentum that he brought to it. The amazing thing to remember about David Beckham is arguably he's not even one of the 10 best players in the world. We haven't seen that impact yet. And there's going to what David Beckham has done, despite this little interlope with AC Milan, is he now has raised the prospect of other great players coming to the U.S. in their prime. And so when someone comes along and says it didn't work, it was a financial disaster, it was a disaster on the pitch, we haven't won a championship yet with David. Ironically, the problem we have with him right now is he's playing so well in Milan, they don't want to let him go until they finish the season. So hopefully he comes back and plays at that level, because if he plays at that level, he's one of the 10 best players in Major League Soccer this year. But more importantly, financially and for the attention and the eyeballs that we have gotten, this guy has moved the needle significantly, and we're going to need more of him, and we'll get there. But even if you look at Seattle, I'm not sure Joe Roth comes in Seattle had we not caught his attention when he went to the David Beckham game when we played Real Madrid. That's when Joe Roth, that day, said, this league is going to make it.
I think we have time for one more question. So I've got the mic.
Hi. With all this digital media, I'm wondering when the day's going to come when the teams don't even have to show up and play, but with the digital...
Like Manchester United did on Saturday last week?
Oh.
But how has the digital media affected the advertising industry and impact on that and sponsorships? Is there any impact at all?
I think it opens up so many incredible platforms. I'll give you an example of what happened with us. We do in every video game, sports game, we can do dynamic advertising. By that I mean, you've all seen a basketball court, there's a scorer's table. That typically has advertising in there. If you're connected, which the great majority of our players are, with our NBA game, as an example, we can load and serve by zip code, in other words, by where you live, specific targeting advertising in that space. Coming up to the presidential election, Barack Obama's people called us and said, we are underperforming with males 18 to 34 in these three states. We want to deliver so many impressions on Friday night between 6 p.m. and 10 p.m. to those people. The best way to do it, we hear, is through your video game. And we delivered that. 48 hours before people were going to the polls, we were delivering, not where he needed, not where he had the votes, but where he needed the votes. And the fact we could identify players who were playing that game and then deliver those impressions to his campaign management team. By the way, the smartest group of marketers I've ever met in my life. That is the future. That never existed 3-4 years ago. So digital platforms are only bounded by your imagination of how you talk and interact with your consumer. And the fact that it's narrowcasting now to that extent rather than broadcasting, it becomes much more targeted and allows more people to invest their marketing money than typically could in the old days of having to do big TV spends. It allows everybody to be much more nimble with their money, much more targeted with their money, and allows them to make really, really almost sniper attacks on that consumer, particularly the consumer we deliver, which is the 18 to 34-year-old male who typically plays hide-and-seek with advertisers. So my answer with that would be it just grows the pie.
All right. I just want to thank the panel once again. Tremendous job. I told you they'd be spectacular. John Skipper, Don Garber, Tim Lewicki, Peter Moore, and David Card, thank you for your participation. And thank all of you for taking valuable time out of your schedules to come watch. I'm Linda Cohn. Have a great night.